don't understand me. That's why they're looking at him and saying, why are you talking to him?
I only come around when the sun goes down and the moonlight covers this town. Airplanes taking off every night and day. People just want to get away in the sun.
Nice record. There's something really nice about that. I don't know what it is. It's Chris Keys, and that's a song called New Day. Good morning. What a new day it is today. It's a new day. It's a new Monday. It's a new me. I'm a new me. Look
Why?
At me. Look at the glow from my face. Remember last week I was almost at death's door?
You weren't here.
That's what I mean. It was almost at death's door, and then I struggled in on Wednesday, and then I just kind of, you know, just barely got through the program. Then Thursday was the same, and then I went away on Thursday, and maybe you thought you'd never see me again. I was so ill, I almost left a spur, you know, like a snail, you know, walking out. Just I leave a trail of dirt. Mm-hmm. You know, I was so ill, and people were going back, and holding garlic up, and I was just everything I turned to, I infected, and I was. But look at me now. Look at the glow in my face.
You look tired.
I'm not tired.
But you look tired.
You ruin everything.
No, you do. You look like a man that didn't sleep very well last night. Did you?
Good morning, everyone.
There's a tiredness about your eyes. Maybe you need your eyes tested.
I'm tired of life. Yeah. Good morning, everyone. I started off so cheerful, but now I've been brought down again. The number to ring if you want to contact this programme, we shall be here until 12 o'clock, is 08459-555-678. There is an email address that one may avail of. It's jerry.anderson at be, avail oneself of. Is that it? Avail oneself of. Jerry.anderson at bbc.co.uk. And of course, the text messaging service is 81771. I want to nail something here.
Sean, I want to nail something too.
Do you?
Yes.
What is it?
I'll nail after you.
You've got nail. By all means, bring your nail out first.
No.
Go on.
No.
Nail something. Go on, nail it now before we start.
Well, there's several things, actually.
Go ahead, then.
A couple of things I heard on.
But the flat, is it?
No.
Well, may I say we're so happy on this station that the flat is coming to Derry Stoke, London, there in the year 2013. There's going to be dancing in the streets, Sean. I see you're enthusiastic. There's going to be dancing in the streets. I'll be saying, get a wee soap of that there, will you? Because we drink a hot there.
Please.
But go ahead.
What?
What's your nail? Bring your nail.
On my nail.
Let me see your
now,
nail.
Now, there's several things I heard you discuss on Friday.
Oh, did you?
Yes.
Right. Go ahead.
But the thing that I want to name now, I want to. Right? I was speaking to a man during the week.
Yes.
This man knows you from your wee boys.
A single wee boy?
I mean, wee boys with short trousers.
I mean, singular?
I
only was one boy.
No, you and him.
All right. Oh, to him and I were wee boys together.
Yes.
Okay. What does he say?
He says that you never ever took part in school events.
That's true.
You never played football. You never played.
Not at school, I didn't know.
You never, ever. He knows you all his life.
I played football.
You're wee boys, both of you.
Okay.
Right? He says, you never. I says, but what about. He said he was a great cricketer, and he laughed. Anderson cricket? I said. And what about the sprint? Apparently, he was a school champion at 100 meters. And this man was laughing. This man thought I was pulling his leg. And I said, he also told us that he competed in the pole vault.
Yes.
And this just creased him up altogether. He says, you never, ever. He said, he was always very quiet at school. He says, but kept to himself. Just me and him were quite friendly, he says. But he says he never, ever played any sort of sport.
I practiced privately.
Yes.
I didn't join the other boys because they were rough. Yeah. By what I used to do is to pole vault. I used to stay in after school and pole vault on my own. insert your own joke here. And also I used to run around the track on my own, pretending I was running with other people and beating them. And I also played football with imaginary players. And I also played Gaelic football and played an imaginary hurley ball.
Yeah.
And I did all that because I was within myself, a little fantasy, little person. And I admit that I was never great with other men or boys. Yeah. I was never a joiner. I'm not a community man. I'd never joined in. I'm a solitary person. The man is right. But I have to say that he's denigrating my achievements. My achievements were many. But, you know, not in the field.
He also lived quite close to you.
Yes.
And
what does he say about my home life?
Oh, not a lot. He knows your brothers very, very well.
But pillars of the community.
I went to school with you, as I said, and lived quite
decent
close
people.
To you. So I said to him, I says, well, funny enough, I said, I heard him talking on Friday morning about a man at the top of his street, a man that taught him all about the stars. Some drunk.
I can name that man. Well, some drunk? No, it's not some drunk.
That's what you said.
I didn't say some drunk.
You...
The other person talked about some drunk. I did not talk about...
What?
The other person
who?
Said that he met a drunk. The person I was talking to said he met a drunk who told him about the stars and things like that.
I said...
Will you stop? And I said, right. Well, I met a man at the top of our street and he stopped me. I was going over getting a pint of milk for my mother. And he called me over and he started telling me about the moon. At no way, at no stage did I say he was a drunk. He was a man who would wander the streets, you know, much like yourself. And I'll name that man now, if you like.
Yeah.
Johnny Cuttrums.
Ah, get a grip. Get a grip.
I see you're impressed by that name. People in Derry Stoke, Londonderry will know that he was a local character.
Yes.
And not a drunkard. And a man who was not like the others. Okay?
You see, and he told you all about the stars.
No, he didn't tell me all about the stars. He made up stories about the moon.
Right, go on.
And he told me about the man on the moon and what he ate. And he looked at the configurations on the planets and all kinds of things. And he asked me what I thought they looked like.
Yeah.
And I would say, look at that. He said, look at the left-hand side of the moon. Look at that. There's craters there. And they're all kind of gathered together. What does that look like? It looks like a kind of an animal to you. And I would say, well, it looks a wee bit like a rabbit. He says, well, there's the man on the moon's dinner. There's the rabbit. And he'd keep talking. He'd ask me to look at all different things and ask me, what what shape they were. And, you know, and I think that's open in a person's mind, because normally you probably didn't even know there was this guy there.
No.
You probably thought it was somebody's roof. Anyway. Will you stop trying to make...
Cuttums.
Yes.
So Cuttums told you about the stars.
Yes, he did.
Right, that's okay.
And what did you call his mate?
Oh, I don't know.
Yes, you do, you know.
I do
you see,
not.
You don't know now. You're sitting there in judgment. What was his mate? And they used to go around with a kind of a placard and stuff, didn't they? They used to sell stuff.
You talking about Hawker?
Yes, Hawker Lynch. You see, you know nothing.
And another thing, too, as
what?
Well. Another thing, too, as
what
well.
What about chalk and water? Eh?
I found out about him. That was a load of nonsense you told.
Well, maybe nonsense to you, but it's the truth to me.
Anyway.
Yes.
Another thing.
Yes.
That you said on Friday morning, and I nearly dropped.
What are you taking notes? What are you, some kind of detective inspector? What are you? What?
I nearly dropped my bowl of porridge.
You dropped your bottle of brandy, you mean? What?
The last time we were talking about Chris Moyles.
Yes.
You were saying how hateful he was, a hateful big
shot. I never said that.
Yes,
I was a very nice person.
No, you did not. And I
you just think that everyone I talk about is hateful. But Chris Moyles is a nice, decent guy.
No, and I said to you, why did you not say that to him when he was here? I said, you were all over him like a rash.
I was not.
I've
never actually spoken to Chris Moyles.
When he broadcast from here, from Radio Foyle.
Yes. Oh, here, yeah, but I never saw him when he was here.
But you were saying how hateful he was.
He was not saying how
That's
hateful
what you
he was.
Said on air.
I might have said that, but it's just talk.
And then you and that other boy, Moylesy.
What other boy?
That other boy you talked to.
Stephen Nolan?
Moylesy.
He has a name, you know.
Moylesy.
I don't call him Moylesy. I've never spoken to Steve. What do you call him? I've never spoken to Chris Moylesy in my life, but I know he's a decent kind of a guy. Because I've seen him in company with people. Anyway, never mind that. Listen, can we get back to this programme here instead of... have you tired calling me a liar yet?
No.
Or is there more?
No, yes, there's one other thing.
Go ahead then.
There's one other thing that the man that I was talking to...
Get it off your chest. Go on.
He brought it up.
Okay.
He said to me, do you see that? You know that story your man comes out with from time to time? That was you.
I know it's me, yes.
You see, you're your man.
That's I know him.
That your man...
Well, my mother used to call my father him in the corner. Him in the corner, look. I never want to be him in the corner. In the corner. What are we doing tonight? We're not going there. Well, why not? Him in the corner doesn't want to go. And when she wanted to attract his attention, she went, hey! Hey! Nobody had names. Well, our cat didn't have a name. He used to call it Pissed. Because I always was. Anyway, go ahead.
He said he doubts very, very much.
Oh, he's not calling me a straight liar.
No, he doubts very, very much the sailor story.
Ah, well, you see, he can't say it's a lie because he wasn't in our
that's
house.
That's why he said, I doubt that happened.
But you doubt near everything I say and do.
This man was in your house often.
I know, but was he sleeping in my bedroom, was he?
No, but he doubts very much that happened. He said, that man's mad, he says.
Well,
mad.
I'm telling you now it did happen. And many's the thing happened that people don't believe because people don't think that I am capable of some of the things that I've done. I'm not an ordinary person. I'm not like you. I do things. I reach out to the unknown.
What's that got to do with a man lying in your bed?
I don't know. I was listening to your show in the car last week, says Shauna. I'm going to nail this thing. When you and Sean were talking about characters and nicknames, as we are indeed still doing, I nearly had to stop the car. I was laughing so hard. My wee boy was alarmed when he realised the car was stopping and his mother making noises. And he was going, what's happening, Mummy? What's happening? We frightened the child. That's what happens sometimes. You know when children in the back seat of the car and your mummy's laughing? And stopping the car, and then you go.
My mother never had a car.
I know. I just thought I'd include
you. Did you think
you in
about
that?
Did your father have a car?
Oh yes, he did. Yes.
Yeah, but in later life.
In later life.
Yeah. Ah, same here.
No, we always had a car.
Eh?
We always had a car.
Had you?
Yeah, ever since I was a small child. My father was very mechanically bent, and he would always he used to fix old cars and stuff like that. He was very mechanical, not like me or any of the other family. He'd always get old jalopies and fix them up. We always had some kind of a car. Yeah. With a runner board on it. I loved the teacher called Smoke a Cola. Do you remember we mentioned that the other day? Mm. It reminded me of a wee girl that was in my school in Derry. This lady's from Derry, obviously. She had a wonky eye. Mm. Remember people used to have wonky eyes? Mm-hmm. You're not allowed to talk about wonky eyes now. Yeah. And she had to have surgery to get it fixed. All went well. And it was looking great until one day she banged it on the corner of a TV set as she was walking past. And the eye went back to the way it was. She probably had what was called a skelly eye.
Yeah.
Right? And from that day forth, she got a nickname. What do you think her nickname was?
No.
She had an eye, a wonky eye, got it fixed, banged it on the TV going past. What was her nickname?
Go on.
ITV. God forgive us. We were cruel little bitches. Yes, you were indeed. It still cracks me up laughing when I think about ITV. I listen to people all the time, and in fact, I got a fancy.
I don't believe that.
Look, see this writing here?
Yeah.
That's what's called a message, a text message.
I don't believe it's someone.
You're going to have to start believing things.
I can't.
You can't believe anything.
I can't believe anything. I can't believe that someone hit their eye in the TV and their skelly eye went back into its hole. You know what I mean?
Well, but you look at you, look at the eyes you have, for God's sake. Sure, nobody would take them. You know, blind man wouldn't take your eyes. Arritis, for God's sake. Yeah. Anyway, my father... Now, here's the thing I'm going to nail. I listen to you people all the time, and I got a fancy DAB radio for my husband at Christmas so I could listen with style whilst working in the office. Now, here's the part. My father tells me that you're quite ignorant and not terribly pleasant in real life. Now, I want to nail this.
Right.
And she goes on to say, I don't believe him.
We were talking about you.
People are saying that I'm ignorant and not very pleasant in real life. Now, that's not true.
Well,
that is not true.
The story's for...
That's not true, I said!
Story's for and against.
I mean, see, it all depends when you catch me.
You can't defend the story of refusing the man to sit at your table.
That's because he was a Jehovah's Witness.
You can't defend that. Yet a man who used to serve you drink in a bar in this town...
Yes.
..said to me, he said, I always found him... We were talking about you as if you were dead last night. He said, I always found him a very quiet fella. No bother at all.
He would
come into the bar, he'd either get his wee vodka and white or sometimes a wee hot whiskey.
Yeah.
And he would sit and he would read his paper.
That's what I do.
And he says, and he would just look up and he would say, could I have another one, please?
What's deviant about that behavior?
Not a thing.
What am I, Julian Simmons? You know what I mean?
But he said to me, people would come into the bar and say, look at that tit for wee. Stuck over there in the corner.
Exactly.
You see, and the barman would turn around and say, and what do you think of that other wee man sitting over in the corner on his own? Is he equally as hateful?
Exactly.
Headphone?
This is what happens to me.
I said, no, but we know Paddy. That's Anderson. You know what I mean?
This is what happens to me because people expect me to be the life and soul of the party,
and I'm not. That's right.
And I sit there and I read the paper and have a wee drink, and people say, oh, listen to him. Look, he's only stuck up, wee shite. Look, he wouldn't even talk to nobody. He doesn't want to talk to anybody. He's sitting reading the paper having a hot whiskey. The same as everybody else in the bar. It's like Linda Bryan once said to me. She said she went into a restaurant one time and she got into conversation with a woman later on in the course of the night, having a wee swally after, you know, wee swally there. And the woman said to her, she said, I thought you were well stuck up, you know, at one stage, you know, and you're not, you're all right. And then she says, well, what made you think that? She said, somebody said to me one time, sometimes you go into a restaurant, just walk past everybody. So ever since that, when I go into a restaurant, I go to the first table. Hello, good evening, how are you? My name is Gerald Michael Anderson. I'm sitting in table 5, having a bite to eat. Who are you? And you are nice to meet you.
You have an aloofness about you. You're a bad comer into a room, boy.
I'm a bad comer into a room, boy?
Yes, you are. Right? Very bad comer.
But see, I try and slide in.
No, you don't. That's the whole point. You come in and you stand there. And it's because of your bad eyesight. You tend to squint.
I don't tend to squint.
You tend to squint.
I have the best eyesight in Derry.
No, you squint.
I can see like...
I know that story.
Anyway, I'd be very... No, but hold on a second.
You squint.
I'm going to ask you one question.
Yes.
Am I wild, ignorant and not terribly pleasant in real life?
No.
Is that good or bad?
I don't know. I don't know what that means.
Right. No, I'm afraid. You ask anybody.
Yeah,
I'm a very friendly person. But I'm not a loud person.
No, you're not.
And I'm not a demonstrative person. No, I'm not a person that tells jokes. I'm not a person that lights up. I'm no good in a crowd. I don't shine. I can only talk to people one at a time. I can't talk to 3 or 4 people. I avoid crowds. I'm shy. I'm inadequate. I'm not normal. But people, because of that, because I'm not friendly, they think there's something wrong with me.
Yeah.
And they say, oh, listen to him on the radio, he's full of crack telling jokes. I never told a joke in my life, except the one about the...
No, don't. No, the one about the boy getting his eyes tested.
Well, that's the only joke I've ever told. The Polish joke. Will I tell it again?
No, please not.
Go on, let me tell it. It's the only joke I know.
No.
Felt like he's into the opticians.
Don't.
The optician says, where are you from? He said, I'm from Warsaw. Is you Poland? Yes, indeed. He said, little trouble with your eyes? He said, yes, I have indeed, yes. He said, okay, would you look at that chart? I said, can you read the first line? He said, read it. I know him. I'd be very obliged if you'd say hello to me. I thought I told that well. But a lot of people would have missed that. I'd be very obliged. Or don't catch it, which is even worse than that. Or what about the other one I like too? Doctor, I don't know what's wrong with me.
Right. Go on. Oh, take these pills.
I don't know what they're for.
I forgot the line, you see.
You see, you're no good. Mm. You're a bad on a Monday. That's because you're drinking a Sunday night. What's wrong with you?
We were talking about you.
I know, but you were drinking at the same time. Mm. You shouldn't drink on a Sunday. Be like me. Be pure. And you're full of beans. I'd be very obliged if you say hello to my friend Maureen Harley in Derry. She was my partner in crime when we were at school. Once upon a time, I had my homework done, which was to write a poem about a natural disaster. Being quick-witted and having a way with words, she whipped up a wee poem called Forest Inferno. It wasn't really my fault when mine got published in the book and hers didn't. I hope she's not still bitter and hope that my public confession will help. That's some Shauna Stewart. And...
Here, would you hear this?
Yes.
I shared a lift with Jerry in the Europa Hotel just before Christmas. It was my first time meeting him, and I thought he was lovely.
There you are. Is that male or female?
Well,
is that male or female?
It's a text message. I can't.
Well, doesn't that say Jim or Anne or something?
I shared a lift with Jerry in the Europa Hotel just before Christmas. Mm-hmm. It was my first time meeting him, and I thought he was lovely.
See?
So I don't know what sex that person is.
Well, hopefully they're female. We don't want men saying I'm lovely.
Especially sharing a lift with them.
Because you can't get out until your floor comes.
No, you're all right, you are.
Thanks.
Nah, you're all right.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah.
I'm just a normal person. Yeah. What's wrong with these people? What do they want? I know Julian, what do they want?
I know.
Hold me in your arms, love. Tell me it's all right. Tell me that there's something. Cause to live and cause to die. And tell me that you'll hold me till the storm has passed, till the clouds of want are scattered and we're free at last. And tell me that we're human. Tell me that we're human. Tell me that you love me. Distances, conditions pull true lovers to and fro, till the soil becomes so arid that there's nowhere love can grow. For each man kills a thing he loves, and each man has to die. Factory existence, lifetime to the workhouse in the sky. So tell me that we're human. Tell me that we're human. Tell me that you love me. And generation ketamine has tranquilized our hearts, quelled the fire in our bellies, leaving only a few sparks. There will be nothing left but individuality. The great mantra of the rulers, but the privilege of the few. So tell me that we're human. Tell me that we're human. Tell me that you love. Not a relic of past ideas. Cause if we don't make a change soon, I see streams of blood and tears.
But we can turn those sparks into bonfires that rage. From Cairo to Madrid, kill the bloodlust of an age. So hold me in your arms, love. Tell me it's all right. Tell me that there's something, cause to live and cause to die. And tell me that you'll hold me till the storm has passed, till the clouds of want are scattered and we're free at last. And tell me that we're human. Tell me that we're human. Tell me that you love me.
That's Conor Kelly. That's a song called Tell Me That We're Human, and you can contact him, Conor Kelly Music at hotmail.co.uk. That was difficult to come out, but I got it out eventually.
On 92 to 95 FM and 1341 medium wave, this is BBC Radio Ulster.
BBC News at 11 o'clock. I'm Anne-Marie Foster. Five people have been taken to hospital after a serious road crash. Two vehicles were involved in the collision on the Newry Road near Hilltown. The road is closed in both directions. Police say the man who died in a car crash in County Tyrone on Saturday was Peter Fugel. The 36-year-old, who was from Londonderry, was the driver of a car that hit a verge on the Omagh to Newton Stewart Road. No other vehicles were involved. Three people have been killed on the roads here so far this year. An air and sea search has resumed for a fisherman missing from a Kilkeel registered boat. The man fell overboard yesterday, 19 miles east of the County Louth fishing village off Cloughorhead. He's believed to be from the Ukraine and is in his 30s. A teachers' union representing 160,000 members has decided to accept the government's plans to reform public sector pensions. The Association of Teachers and Lecturers said members recognised it was the best deal in the current economic climate. The boss of Royal Bank of Scotland has agreed to give up a bonus of nearly £1 million in shares. RBS Chief Executive Stephen Hester made the decision after Labour decided to hold a vote in Parliament on whether he should be forced to forgo it. The party's leader, Ed Miliband, says the government had the power to stop Stephen Hester receiving a bonus in the first place, but refused to use it.
I think David Cameron has shown himself to be completely out of touch with the British people on this issue. But we've now got to learn the deeper lessons, because we've got to have responsibility in the boardroom when everybody else's living standards are being squeezed. That's why I say tax the bankers' bonuses and give ordinary employees a say on top pay in every company.
Sport now with Paul Gilmore.
Frank Lampard is rated 50-50 for Chelsea's Premier League game at Swansea tomorrow. Lampard missed Saturday's FA Cup win at QPR with a calf injury. Brazil midfielder Ramirez will be out for 3 to 4 weeks after suffering medial ligament damage. Former Coleraine striker Leon Knight is today expected to finalise a move to a new club. Knight has previously been linked with Glentoran. Australian Open runner-up Rafa Nadal says he felt the epic decider against Novak Djokovic was never going to finish. Djokovic eventually won in 5 hours and 53 minutes, making it the longest Grand Slam final of all time. And Robert Rock says holding off Rory McIlroy and Tiger Woods to win golf's Abu Dhabi Championship is the highlight of his career.
Now the weather forecast with Angie Phillips.
Mostly cloudy with the rain which has been affecting the east this morning, edging towards the west and lingering there on and off through the afternoon. The eastern counties will become drier by then, with perhaps a few brighter spells developing across parts of Antrim and East Down. A cold day for all parts though, especially in the chilly southeasterly breeze, which will be quite gusty around the coast. Highs only 4 or 5 Celsius.
BBC News.
BBC Radio Ulster. Travel news.
There's been a diesel spill on the M2 between Temple Patrick and Dunsilly. Motorway maintenance teams have been dispatched, but drivers heading north are advised to slow down in the area. Elsewhere and in Hilltown, the Newry Road remains closed in both directions between Ballydoo Crossroads and Carmeen Road. That's because of a serious accident at the Seven Sisters. Diversions are in place. At George Best Belfast City Airport, the 20 past 9 arrival from Newcastle is further delayed and is now expected at 20 to 2, while the quarter past 12 arrival from Glasgow is also expected at 20 to 2. And passengers travelling to and from Dublin today should check with their airline before travelling to the airport. Ryanair has cancelled flights because of a general strike in Belgium. Elaine Sutherland reporting.
Travel news on BBC Radio Ulster.
On Talkback with Wendy Austin today, Ulster Unionists in crisis yet again. Now David McNary's walked from the Assembly Group. Where does it leave the party? Is it on its last legs? A Labour MP says the Tottenham riots might not have happened if parents still smacked their kids. Is he right? And how much cleavage is too much cleavage? Carol Vorderman's in the tabs today. Some of our local lovelies too. Have a look. Should they be covering it up or flaunting it? What do you think? And it's official. Women are better at parking than men. It's a scientific fact. How do you like that, boys? How's your reversing? You can tell me on Talkback at 12.
I can't. My big end is gone. Slap a hoodie today. 5 minutes past 11 o'clock. Bob Kennedy and his band, who performed in this programme a couple of weeks ago, are performing live in HMV Castle Place in Belfast at 1 o'clock today, also signing copies of the new album. Go up there. Go up there today. Could do that. Do that. Do that now. Do that immediately.
We'll be bound for glory.
Hold on a second. These things are starting before we're even ready. Hold on a second. They start too quickly. There. I like them when they start at the start. That's the start. It's much better when they start at the beginning. This is from Bob Kennedy's new album called The Sailor's Revenge. This is called Celtic Sea.
We'll go down together. Time to dream, not to sleep. We'll go where there's treasure, far away across the deep. Will you come with me? Will you come with me into the wild and cold Celtic Sea? I have stood on this corner like a man cast away. I want last one more summer. I can't stand another day. Go while we still can. Will you
come with me. You come with me into the wild and cold Celtic sea. I'm a Celtic. You come with me into the wild and cold Celtic sea. Thank you.
That's a girl that you may have forgotten about. Her name is Breonna Corrigan. Breonna Corrigan, should I say. And she was the lead singer about 10 years ago with Beautiful South. And then she went away and, well, disappeared into obscurity. I have to say, by her own choice. She's been living in Dublin there for the last 10 years. But now she's putting a foot back in the music business. And that's her new single, which is called 13 Wonderful Love Songs, which is written, which is taken from her forthcoming album, which is called Red Bird. And it says here, Nilox say, the single will be available in a limited quantity for fans to download via Brianna's Facebook page. I have resigned from Facebook.
Well. Facebook and...
are you on Facebook or Twitter? Twitter?
No, tweet? Twitter.
Do you tweet? No?
No.
Good.
No. Because, as we said, someone... Who was it said about Twitter and Facebook? It's for the vain and the insane. And I think that's quite a good description.
How dare you call those people vain and insane? Just someone, because you don't like it.
Facebook is for the vain and for the insane.
No, it's for the people who really now want to talk to the people that they didn't want to talk to when they were at school. A change has come over them. And before that was a track called Celtic Sea from Bob Kennedy from his new album, which is called The Sailor's Revenge. And Bob Kennedy, as I mentioned before in brief, in passing, is performing live in HMV Castle Place today at 1 o'clock. So get down there now.
I see your girl's making a comeback. She's touring again.
What girl would that be?
Up the Hill girl. The girl ran up the hill.
That'll be Kate Bush.
Kate Bush, yeah.
Well, she never toured before. I don't know why she would do it again. Yeah, she only did one tour, one short tour in her whole life. Anyway,
there's a man on TV and you should do something about it.
Okay, what?
Or something has to be done about him.
Rufus Hound.
No, this man has got...
Keith Lemon.
This man has got the worst hair on television.
Yeah, well, isn't that your man out of the Big Brother, Freddy, whatever you call it?
No, come on. There's a man with very, very bad hair. And this man, I would say, is a man that would be on Facebook because I think there is a streak of vanity there. Any man that would sit in front
there's
of
nothing. Hand. No, there's nothing wrong. If you go on Facebook, it doesn't necessarily mean that you're vain.
Aye, it does.
No, it doesn't. It does. To you it does, but not to normal people. But
well,
you're not a normal person.
Well, I mean, the people writing in the
people
paper.
Who want to communicate do not necessarily are not necessarily vain. They just want to communicate. I just find it odd that people should want to know something.
I mean, why
people.
Would you tell anyone that you've just gone to the shop or going heading out now going to buy the
That's
paper?
Twitter. That's a different thing entirely.
Why would you do that?
Because you feel the need to do it.
Yeah, why?
I don't know. I'm not like that, neither are you.
That's vanity.
But I'm not. You cannot say that everybody's the same as that. People who tweet are, I think, a little suspect. But Facebook is a different thing because Facebook is an interesting thing, providing it doesn't get out of hand. But Twitter's.
But why would you
intrusive.
Write anything about anyone?
It's for people like Nolan.
It's for people, like vain people.
I know.
That's what I'm saying.
But you start off by saying that Facebook was for people who are
yes,
vain.
I think so too as well.
No, but you're wrong there.
All right then.
Okay, here's a person who's...
But what about the man with the hair?
Who is he? Name him and get over with. Move
guess.
On.
No, you guess.
No, name him and move on.
Why?
Name him and move on. Name him and move on. Why don't you just name
All
him
right,
and
then.
Move on?
Andrew Neil. Am I right?
He's great hair. Yeah.
Isn't it awful?
The last comb over.
It's awful.
The last comb
and he's dying it.
Mm-hmm. He will not give in to the dimming of the day.
Oh.
I am hoping that you might have a minute or two to give me some assistance through your show, says Ethna. I unfortunately have lost my mobile phone. Very foolish, I know. It was a Samsung Galaxy S2 and it was lost in the area of York Gate in Belfast in Friday past. I think I may have foolishly dropped it and getting out of the car. This is what happens. People shouldn't do this. Put their phones in their laps while they're driving, and they forget they're there, and then they get out of the car and smash it goes in the street underneath the car, and they forget all about it.
The phone shouldn't be anywhere near their lap when they're driving. The phone should be in the glove compartment or in their handbag or in their pocket.
And preferably in a safe blessed by a bishop.
Yes.
I think I may have foolishly dropped it. I had some lovely photographs of my mother on it. My mother has dementia, and I had a great video of her singing on it. Unfortunately, she's not able to sing like this anymore as her condition has progressed, and the video really means so much to me. The phone is barred, so nobody can use it anyway. If anybody has come across this in the car park, can I appeal to them to hand it either to the Tesco customer services in York Gate or York Road Police Station. It would be so much appreciated. Got a contact number here as well. That's from Ethne Murphy. Anyone who finds a Samsung Galaxy S2, which is barred and it's no good to anybody, unless you go in and get it unlocked and then people will know who you are and then you'll think you stole it. So we can't do that. And the lady's got photographs of her mother's singing, which she can't do anymore.
I'm getting obsessed now, you know, with people.
You've been obsessed since I knew you.
You know, people who are deliberately breaking the law. People who deliberately break the law.
If you'd have been a Catholic, you'd have been a policeman.
They annoy me. Really do. It's really.
You know, you missed your whole... If you'd been born a Protestant, you'd have been wearing a uniform since you were 10.
I'm telling you now. You see people who use their mobile phone when driving a car.
Really, shut up.
No, it's wrong. I'm at the point now of turning and going after them in the car.
Well, do you know the next step after that? Don't be talking to the person beside you when you're driving. Your wife sitting beside you and she's saying to you, do you think we should go to that wedding? Will I wear you in that wedding? Shut up, I'm driving. Do you ever do that? Do you ever say that?
No, but...
Same thing.
Let me think about it.
I've got this second-hand gag here. I'll sell it to you.
You've started something.
Do you know, I was talking to young Nolan there about English people listening to him talking to me. And
how can you report people? There must be some way.
There must be a phone number. It's the side of every pig and Land Rover in the country.
There has to be some way you can report. You see a person driving...
And farmer!
Yes!
And farmer!
Tout!
Quisling! Lundy! Quisling!
There has to be some way.
No, why don't you just go up and hit the people?
No, there has to be, there has to be some way to prevent them.
Whenever you see people doing things you don't like, you should just go up and thump them. Now, that's about taking it out of your system. You end up in jail, of course, but it'll get it out of your system and you'll feel much better.
The two things that I have, honestly, is the parking on double yellow lines and driving and using the mobile phone.
Do you know what I've seen too? People who are walking
parking
about...
Parking in corners.
One of the things I've noticed too is that people are slamming their doors quite loudly.
Aye, my wife started that. You're right. You are right.
I'm only joking!
No!
My
wife has started that. Like, she said, ah! Before I said, gently. I said, here, gently.
No, this is later on at night. This is not during... I'm talking about during the... The day.
When she gets out of the car, I have to shout there. Gently!
I hope nobody hears you. Great shows last week, kid. I heard the dreadful news that Mr. Coyle lost his first communion money whilst out on a solitary nocturnal stroll. Yes, we mentioned that the other day. It was a terribly sad thing. All police leave has been cancelled in Derry, and a helicopter fitted with a metal detector is patrolling the highways and byways traversed by a nighthawk. Mr. Coyle, heavily sedated, keeps mumbling in his sleep, "There was a half crown. A shilling, two tanners and a threepenny bet." Sean is not taking the loss well. He chased a grief counsellor away with a rolled up copy of the Derry Journal. I defy any grief counsellor to go to a house and be able to stand up against a rolled up copy of the Derry Journal. That's an evil paper to be hit with. The doctor said Sean should be left alone to deal with his grief. Let's hope that someday he will find closure. Tommy, my cat, looked up from his shredded tweet and said, which contained 59% Scaldy, of course, and said, "He's mad as hell and he's not going to take it anymore." "Of whom are you talking, feline?" I yelled. "David McNary," said Tommy. I saw him barging out of Stormont yelling, "Up with this, I will not put..." "Dave, boy," I said, putting my arm round him. "What's up, kid? Who's annoyed you?" "Tom Elliott, that's who," yelled David. "Tom Elliott, our magnetic, silver-tongued leader, called him into his office and he said, 'Mr. McNary, you've been spouting off the press. This displeases me. You don't want to make me angry. You wouldn't like it, but I'm angry. You're on the Education Committee. I'm taking you off that committee. You have a big mouth, McNary. I shall replace you on the Education Committee with someone who knows piles more about education than you do. Go now. Don't let the door hit your arse on the way out." I turned my baseball back cap to front, pulled up my hoodie and said, "And did he take that abuse from Farmer John?" "Well, yes and no," said Tommy. When David McNary reached the gates of Stormont, he turned around and roared, "Sodbuster! I hope the slurry in your tank takes on the consistency of congealed porridge and brusts the rivets on your dung spreader." "What a great comeback," I yelled. "I must commit that to memory and forget all about it." Tommy then cast a dirty look in the general direction of Iran and said, "How close Sinn Féin and the DUP have become. Did you see Peter Robinson and Martin McGuinness at the McKenna Cup final on Saturday, GAA? groundbreaking, I yelled. Historic, mind you. Peter doesn't know much about it. He kept shouting, handball, handball, and asked Martin, what time does the fight start? When do they start hitting each other? Is it half time or after? Groundbreaking. It was a very generous gesture by Peter Robison, said Tommy. McGinnis will have to respond in kind. I flicked the locust off the butter and said, Martin said he will shake hands with the Queen and may attend a Poppy Day parade. Oh, it'll take more than that, said Tommy. There's a rumour going around Stormont that come July, Martin will march black hats down Garvaghy Road, overcome with the historical significance of it all. I grabbed the clock off the wall and ran down the street yelling, peace in our time! Peace in our time, I yelled. Peace in our time. I'm worried about myself. No, I am worried about myself.
It's more than you worried.
I begin to think I'm starting to dissemble. Fall apart, so to speak.
Some crazy Englishman is calling me out, but I'm not going, no, I'm not going outside. I said I'd be a good boy, cross my heart and hope to die. I'm not going, he can do what he like. The rats are in the basement, the cats and dogs are on the street. They've got the knowing, love, they've got the knowing of me. They know that I love ya, but I am afraid to speak. In the midst of beauty, I am a schoolboy geek. With a crush almighty, her red nails are torn my soul. She crept behind me, she pinned my mind to the wall. My chest is pounding like a beating drum. My chest is pounding. My chest is pounding like a beating drum. Every time she looks at me. Every time she look at me. Does she flow the towpath, or she walk the eglantine? Does she fly the high street, 'cause she sleeps within my mind? Does she dig the folk scene, does she dance the rock and roll? The champagne lifestyle, 'cause I'm on lemonade dough.
Her baby's in the cradle,
the cats and dogs are counting sheep.
God lives with the angels,
and silence dwells between my teeth. Tree tangled fish and twine, it catch the resting blackbird. She saw the frost outside, yet she's got me running scared. My chest is running like
a beating drum.
My chest is pounding. My every
That's Baz McSherry, and I'm really glad I had time to, well, I eventually got round to listening to that. I've had that for a while, and people have been telling me about him for a long time, and I only had a chance to listen to that first track, and I'm going to be listening to the rest of it with great care and attention. That's called Dancing Feet, and that's Baz McSherry, BazMcSherry. And his new album is called The Looking Drawer. I don't even know anything about him. People are fighting back. People, you know, you should be very careful what you say.
I was going to ask you about Baz there. Baz, so you know nothing about him?
I don't know.
No. It sounds like Mark Jimino.
Maybe a little.
I mean, that,
maybe a little.
In a nice way.
That's all right. I understand that. Yeah, I understand. Yeah.
It's very good.
He is indeed, yes.
Who's fighting back?
The people who are on Facebook are fighting back.
Yes.
And they're saying, what are you all about? Meaning you, not me.
Yeah.
Facebook and radio aren't much different. There you are, Coyle, on every day spouting off what pub you're in last night. Who you saw when you walked in.
That's a private conversation between me and you.
Events that transpired on the except that we're on the radio. Yeah, events that transpired on this night, what a noise. And people with mobile phones, and then at 5 o'clock it's just time to take the ball off the pitch. And some of us don't have a radio show, tend to do all this on Facebook. You see, you do it, and you've got a way of doing this. You've got a means of expression. What's the difference, he says? Please explain. You've got a means of expression. You've got your own radio show and you give out to me. If I wasn't here, what would you do? You'd be on Facebook giving out to somebody else.
No, I wouldn't.
Yes, you would.
I wouldn't.
I think it'd be a good idea to inform your listeners of the spanner of Connor Kelly's name. If you write in C-O-N-O-R, one R, in Connor Kelly, you get a smattering of Irish rebel music, which we've had enough of this last 100 years. But if you spell two N's, C-O-N-N-O-R, you get good stuff. That's Connor Kelly with two N's. Worth mentioning that there are two N's in his name. There's a man who calls me a slabber. You're on air at 7:30, slabbering on your favourite subject yourself. This is what we do here. And you're forever telling that bloody joke about the DA haircut. What DA haircut? Do I tell a joke about a DA haircut? Do I?
No, you tell the it's the Tony Curtis joke you tell.
I haven't told that for days. Tell Jerry to double the dose, take 2 tablets 3 times daily, Sean O'Reilly from OMA, referring to some kind of illness that he feels I may have. I saw Jerry in Jackson's Hotel one morning. I was at the bar and he was over at the window reading his paper. I said, do you mind if I sit down? He said, sorry, the seat is taken.
Yeah.
I went back a few times and there was no one there at all. One. Yeah. And I came once, excuse me, do you mind if I have a chat? Do you? You know what I mean? You don't want them, do you? And I feel the same when I'm kissing my paper.
Right.
If I'm reading the paper, I like to read the paper. I don't want people going over and saying, I know you're reading the paper, but listen, what about you, all right? You know, you feel like saying, get away! See the ready me came out
I
there?
I hear that. Did you hear now, that? Do what I enjoy.
Well.
See, I enjoy people saying, no, you're sitting on your own.
But I don't believe I did that. I don't believe I would have said to someone sitting there.
I believe that.
No, I wouldn't do that.
Yes, you would.
Because it would appear obvious to me that that person would come back later and see nobody there.
No.
And I would be, well, branded a liar, basically. I heard...
No, I enjoy when people say you're sitting on your own and you're having your wee drink and you're just sitting there.
Mm-hmm.
And people would say, or someone would say, you're very quiet tonight.
Yes.
What are you... You sit on your own. You're very quiet tonight. Not much crack out of you tonight.
Mm-hmm.
What are you supposed to... What do they expect you to be doing?
Huh? The reply they deserve is just what happened there now. Just nothing. Now, the one that I don't like is, what's that crack with you? And you have to answer.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway.
Any crack?
What's a crack with you? Come on, what's a crack, boy? Hey, what's a crack with you? No crack in particular. And they go, what? Anyway, here's a gentleman said the best nickname he saw. There was a policeman in his small town. He doesn't mention where it is. And he's very short. They called him Laptop because he was a small PC.
Hey, Laptop, what about you? You all right?
Jerry, you don't need to get a copy of what I don't... Sorry, you need to get two copies. You need to get a copy of what I do, Connor Kelly. Well, I'm going to invite Connor Kelly in this program. I'm going to give her a ring after this program today, as a matter of fact. I met Jerry at the Black Box one night. He wasn't interested in me. He was standing talking to a small blonde at the bar.
You see?
What do you expect?
Yeah.
You know, that's probably, I'm not saying that I would be a person but lech after a woman, you know.
Of course not.
I mean, even if she was... You know,
yeah,
showing her things. You know, I'm standing there talking to people, trying to be civil. Do you think I'm going to be nasty to a girl standing there, especially with blonde hair and not wearing much clothes?
I couldn't get out to the golf course over the weekend.
Could you not?
Because of the rain.
Oh, must have been torn.
And I was just looking at the TV list.
Pace the ceiling.
I went, I checked every channel that I can get.
Here's an idea. Why don't you get a book and read it?
And I just wanted to see something on the television. Mm-hmm. And spotted a Western from 1950. Barbara Stanwyck was.
Ah, well, you see, that's heaven for you.
No, I wouldn't ask.
With her big lungs.
That was terrible.
What did you watch it?
I don't know what I watched.
What was it called? Red River Rock or something?
Something like that. I don't know what it was.
Jerry, why did
I tell you what it was called? The Furies.
Really?
Yeah.
The Furies. They've been going a long time. Why is it when Sean tells you there's a call on one or two, you keep blethering on? Because I don't want to talk to anybody. That's why. A caller phoned to say they found a grey and white Lhasa Apso dog wearing a silver collar on the Dungiven Road beside the Good Shepherd Convent. That's here in Derrystoke, Londonderry. I used to go to the Good Shepherd Convent. I used to bring over bundles of clothes for my mother. I used to walk up and it was a Magdalene laundry.
Then we didn't know.
We didn't know then. Yeah. I used to see all the guys. I used to look around. There was a wooden gate there and I used to be able to look through the cracks in it. And see all the girls wearing their green smocks. And you say, what are those girls doing in there? You didn't know until later. Things you didn't know. Facebook is for the nosy. And I'm like that, says Sandra. Andrew Neil's hair is of the same Shane Warne variety. Oh, I see. You know Shane Warne, the cricketer.
Yeah.
I think he's called the dog since he met your woman. Right, well, good, right. I'm going to play some music now.
It's brilliant. What a decision.
Yeah. I don't make this lightly.
I could kick your ass. says I couldn't sleep tonight. Juarez, you made me weep tonight. Across the Rio Grande, I saw your poverty lights. Good night, Juarez, good night. Juarez, I used to paint the town. Now you've gone and turned it upside down into a dark and bloody battleground. Good night, Juarez, good night. Our Lady of the Seven Sorrows just caught the last bus out. She said seven sorrows used to fit the bill, but I need 10,000 now. The mariachi horns are silent, the guitars don't make a sound. The children have all disappeared, or they're hiding underground. The tourist market's empty now. You wouldn't recognize this town. Why they even tore the bull ring down. Good night, Juarez, good night. Vuela, vuela, palomita. You ragged and torn dove of peace. Fly across this burning desert where the body is alive beneath. Bring me back one faded rose, a sign of love and hope, and drop it down on this broken city, for it all goes up in smoke. Juarez, I had a dream today. The children danced as the guitars played, and all the violence up and slipped away. Good night, Juarez, good night. The children danced as the guitars played. Good night, Juarez, good night.
The Man from God Knows Where, that's Tom Russell. The track before that was a track from Dion from an album called, I think it's falling around me, called The Son of Skip James. That was a track called The Son of Skip James. And that one was called, hold on a second.
Sounded lovely.
Yes, that one is called Juarez from an album by Tom Russell, his new album, which is called Mesabi, M-E-S-A-B-I. Have you ever been to Juarez?
No. You made out on Friday morning too, as well.
Stop casting things up
no,
to me.
No, no, these are things I do. When I'm taking my porridge, I note, I say, well,
when you're right, taking your porridge.
Yeah, okay.
Yes.
And you said that I doubted the fact that the Indians had small horses.
Yes, you did.
I did not.
Yes, you did.
No, no, I did not.
I have many witnesses.
No, I didn't. What I said
what you did was you couldn't figure out how I could get up on them.
No, I said that you were not capable of throwing your leg on a horse. Which you said you did. You said you stood.
Yes, I did.
You stood at beside the end of the horse, and you threw it, and you jumped up on the horse, and then you galloped off down the canyon, and with the wind blowing your long
what remained
hair,
of my hair. Yes,
your wind blowing your hair, and you felt like Geronimo or someone. I doubt very, very much that you threw your leg on a horse.
Why do you doubt this?
Because you.
Even when the evidence is presented to you that mustangs are small and that the horses... do you know how high the stirrup, the what do you call the thing you put your foot in?
You don't have a thing.
The point is, you do have a thing.
You
like
don't.
That.
You said you had no thing.
Oh, you don't need a thing.
But you hadn't got a thing. That's, you said that you stood beside the horse, you held onto its mane, and you threw your leg up on the.
Because so you jump up. But you don't jump from a stand and start.
Well, where do you jump from?
You jump off of a kind of a stone or something.
Ah, that's not what you said, you see. And that's why I
didn't tell you that I adopted a position.
Yes, you said you
equilibrium.
Were,
you know what I mean? I just said I jumped up on a horse.
You said you were standing beside the horse, and I asked you.
I mean, didn't say what I didn't say what I was standing on.
You didn't say that. You said
I was standing on a Mexican. Juarez is in Mexico. Juarez is the scariest place I've ever been. It's when you go to El Paso, down in El Paso, and then you go over the border, then you're in Juarez, Cuidad. That's the scariest place I've ever been. No, it's not the scariest place I've ever been. It was scary enough because of a lot of boys being shot then because of drug wars. Now, the scariest place I ever was Chihuahua. And that's the place where it's way down in the Sonora. And you go way down, down, down south, right in the middle of Mexico. That's where there are no tourists and nobody going, do you want a McDonald's? None of that. And the army stop you. At that time, the Mexican army, they were some
what
kind
you doing
of. They're making a film.
What film?
What do you mean, what film? But year before last.
What?
It's by James Kirker.
Oh, you followed
I'm his sorry.
Train.
I'm sorry to be accurate here. I'm sorry to tell something that isn't a lie. I know it surprises you.
Yeah.
You know what? I'm actually telling you the truth.
But,
you know?
You know, a film.
You know?
A film?
Yeah. Yeah. So anyway, we're going down through this, and do you know the way here years ago when the trouble was on and the army would stop you and mm-hmm. say, good evening, sir, where are you going? Mm-hmm. And you'd say, what's your name? And you go, Mickey Mouse. No, you know, you could mess around with them, you know, because you knew, well, at that time, you didn't think they would shoot you. But here, do you see when you're in Mexico and the guy comes over and there's a button off his tunic and he's smoking. There's a fag in his mouth. He says, where are you going? You don't mess with that guy. Mm-hmm. You don't mess with him. And anyway, we were in Chihuahua, in the hotel, having a bite to eat, you know. Mm-hmm. And the time came, you know, like 9:30, 10 o'clock. And I listen, and I hear from outside the sounds of the mariachi, the sounds of the night. Mexico coming alive at night. So I went up to the guy in the reception. I said, listen, is there any nice wee bar or something we could go to? You know, music and that kind of thing. He said, if I were you, I'd stay here. That's how rough it was. Ooh. Why am I telling you this?
I was enjoying that.
Anyway,
you were telling it wonderfully well.
Thank you.
I wish there was more.
There is more, but I'm not going to tell you. I was in a coffee shop and Jerry was having his coffee and reading the paper. Suddenly, I took a terrible nosebleed. I had to stand up very quickly and leave. He looked at me and he went,
yes. Yes, I could well believe
it. I don't believe it. These people are ganging up on me. I've never to anybody in my life, except the woman with the baby, and I went worse than that to her. Ask Sean, since when has driving become so difficult we can't so much as pick our nose without busybody interfering? Well, you're a busybody.
I figured your
way that people's noses would be taken away from them and they'd be locked up somewhere and only picked on holidays of obligation. Baz McSherry sounds more like Mark Conn. Well, maybe he does. Great show, boys, talking about lovely people, apart from Jerry. Isn't it lovely to see the lovely Joe Scott back at reading the news after baby number two? Hasn't she got a lovely twinkle in her eye? You know, I noticed that. You know Joe Scott who reads the news?
Mm-hmm.
She's lovely. She really is. And you want to see her. There's a sparkle in her eye. And Barbara Morrow says that we were talking about a gentleman, a character called Crazy Horse, on this programme the other day. She says, I think I met Crazy Horse in the 1980s. He told me his name is Mr. Kitchen. My daughter, who was 16 at the time, saw him leaving a pub, dragging a little pub on a lead. A little pup. Sorry, a little pub on a lead. A little pup on a lead. She said, Mum, buy that pup for me. Buy that pup for me. We lived in Green Island at the time and had moved over here from England. I did not buy the pup, but the next morning she said, I'm going up to the falls to buy that pup. So I went up with her and someone directed us to the Crazy Horse's house and we bought the pup for a fiver. My daughter called the pup Kit after Mr. Kitchen. Now, why is she telling me this stuff?
I don't know.
Neither do I.
You know that female news presenter, Fiona... Is it Fiona? You know the girl that does the antique show? Is it Fiona Bruce? Fiona...
Yes, Fiona Bruce. Fiona yeah. See, Bruce. We are not helping you here.
Yeah, Fiona Bruce.
I'm trying to teach you to get the names before you start telling the stories.
You do...
Fiona Bruce.
You do a wonderful... impersonation of Fiona Bruce. And every time Fiona Bruce comes on to read the news, I see you. And I said to myself,
that's what she looks at you.
But I wish people could see. Wish people could see you do it. And it's so accurate. And I never realised it until you did the And then that night she came on the TV and I just laughed. I said, that's
now what she does, we can't do this because it's radio. And I'm looking at you now. You see, you're looking at the TV and I'm Fiona Bruce.
And I'm saying, why does she just look?
I'm saying, there's been an earthquake in Chile. I just look at you like that. See? And what she's actually saying, wouldn't you love to go with me? That's what she's basically saying.
I don't think so.
Oh, yeah.
No, she's not.
Absolutely.
But she never speaks before the news. No, she. The news starts, and for about 4 seconds, she just stares.
She
stares.
The camera, but what she's saying is, look at me. Look at me.
Is that what she's saying?
Look at me. Wouldn't you love to be me? Wouldn't you? Wouldn't you? Wouldn't you love to be me? How would you like to take me out and buy me a drink? Hey, would you like that, wouldn't you? That's what she's saying.
I never think of
that. That's because you're not normal. Caller phones to say they lost a set of car keys in the city, and it's necessary to put the Derry in the brackets. On Saturday, there are 2 keys, a Tesco and Extra Vision card on the key ring. A Tesco and Extra Vision card on the key ring? I've never heard of that.
But Fiona Bruce hasn't... She doesn't... No, she doesn't do anything for you.
I know she doesn't do anything for you.
But why is she saying that?
Because she thinks she's doing it because she knows how to look at people. Like that.
That's the way she looks at people, yes.
I'm people looking at you like you that. Look at,
I don't like you looking at me like that.
She looked, small earthquake in Chile, not many killed. You want me, don't you? Stop this, I'd carry on. I was all right before I came in here. I've turned into some kind of monster. Eamon Holmes doesn't do that.
No.
He goes, I want to eat you. I want to eat everything.
Never give all the heart, for love will hardly seem worth thinking of to passionate women if it seems certain, and they never dream that it fades out from kiss to kiss. For everything that's lovely is but a brief, dreamy, kind delight. Oh, never give the heart outright, for they, for all smooth lips can say, have given their hearts up to the play. And who could play it well enough if deaf and dumb and blind with love? He that made this knows all the cost, for he gave all his heart and lost.
It's a one-time thing. It just happens a lot. Walk with me and we'll see what we have got. My footsteps are ticking like water dripping from a tree, walking a hairline and stepping very carefully. Worn out at the knees, hearing, muffled, seeing, blind. Soon it will hit the deep freeze. And something is cracking. I don't know where. Ice on the sidewalk. Brittle branches in the air. The sun is blinding, dizzy golden dancing green through the park in the afternoon, wondering where the hell I have been.
Oh, that's good. That's, of course, Suzanne Vega from an album called Close Up, Volume 3, States of Being. It's a track called Cracking. Good to hear you playing Tom Russell, who was at the Errigal last week. I missed that and I forgot to tell the people and everything. I don't know. Sometimes I wonder. I wasn't well last week. You know, I'm not. Nothing that happened last week I can take responsibility for. I was near death's door.
You were bad.
I was bad.
A man expressed concern.
I share his concern.
No, a man approached me and said to me, he says, I believe Anderson's not well.
Not long for this world.
I said, he's already, he's rallying.
Thank God I'm okay. I'm 100% now again. Yeah. You know, my health is everything.
Oh,
I missed your show in Belfast on the 18th of January. I've heard a little snippet, but I'm told that your show had made mention of Sunday Liston's visit to Belfast. We did indeed. Matt Fox, this is. My grandfather owned Bannon's store at the time when he had his press conference, Sonny Liston, that is. We have loads of photographs of the day and more stories, most probably exaggerated with the passage of time. I'd love to get a copy of the show that day to send over to my grandfather, who now lives most of the time in Spain. I wonder, could we get a copy of that? Would that be possible?
Of what?
What I just explained.
The show?
On January the 18th. We will try and get that for the gentleman. Yeah. Will you maybe make a little note of that and I'll ignore it completely?
Sonny Liston.
January 18th. I just wanted to let you and your listeners know, says Janet Dowd, about our gig on Friday. Our six-piece band will be playing in the Webb Theatre in Newton Arts on Friday the 3rd of February at 8 p.m. It's a very good theatre, that. It's the only privately owned theatre in Northern Ireland and it's a really lovely, intimate venue. So there we are, going to see Janet Dowd and her band, who are very, very good. And caller phones in to say, Jerry, there's an amazing night in a local bar here in Derrystoke, Londonderry, called Bennigan's on a Friday night. The local talent here is brilliant and the young people out supporting local music is fantastic to see. And apparently a gentleman called Joe Nealis should be congratulated for the use of the facilities. Keep on playing good local music. We will do the best we can because, after all, do you know what we're here for? What? The public good. We're not here for private gain.
Dickie Rock, 75.
He is not, is he?
He is.
Is he really?
Yeah.
Good God.
Last year's troubles are so old-fashioned. The robber on the highway, the pirate on the seas. Maybe it's the clothing that's so entertaining. The earrings and the swashbuckling blouses that please.
Chuck Berry is older than the Queen.
So,
Memphis, Tennessee.
Times that have passed now, but nobody these days.
I think it's all over for all of us.
Over there, the petticoats of ladies of virtue. You can hardly tell them from the petticoats of sin. Last year's troubles. Last year's troubles.
That's the end of another programme full of interesting whatever it was and useful things wherever they might have been. Back tomorrow at the same time, about 10:30. Goodbye. Why is it they're suffering?